Hi. This is a 20-minute session, so I will try and keep it short and sweet. But if you have questions, do stop and ask. Okay? So I'm going to start off by telling you guys that this is based on our real experience. This is not being tested. This particular model that we're going to speak of is not being tested in the open a lot. We've just used it at our own company at Geek Trust, and it found out it worked for us. So we're sharing this with you. Lots of things we still don't know yet. We don't know how we'll do that at scale. We don't know how we'll do it in a complex team structure. But this is what we learned, and we're here to share that. All right? Now, before we start, and we'll start with introductions, just want to know the how many, say, developers in the room? Okay. Product owners, Scrum Masters? Okay. And project managers, testers? Cool. So we've got a good mix, right? And I think this will impact almost everybody. Anybody working at a startup? Anybody working at a startup? Nobody? Okay, one. Okay. All right, so you might understand our pain better than the others, but let's see. We'll try and explain what we're trying to do. So quick introduction. My name is Krishnan. I used to work at ThoughtWorks. I worked at ThoughtWorks for 10 years. I was mostly doing project management. When I left ThoughtWorks, I was handling delivery for the entire Bangalore office. So I have a fair degree of experience in Agile, Scrum, coaching. I used to do coaching in the UK, in Australia, in the US, then back in here in Bangalore as well. So my primary role has been in ThoughtWorks and in Agile and all that.
I'm Sneha. Can you guys hear me? Yeah, okay. I'm Sneha. I also used to work at ThoughtWorks. I was at ThoughtWorks for about 6 years. I started off as a application developer. I've played various roles, moved into business analysis and project management mostly.
And we earlier last year we started up with Geek Trust. We're in the recruitment space. You can read more about us later. We don't have time to talk about that now. Now, moving on. How many of you have had the opportunity or the need to prioritize features? Hands up, please. How do you prioritize today? How do you prioritize? What's that? Value. Value to the client. Who else said anything else? Gut feel. Good answer.
Nice one.
Okay, so those who said business value, how do you define that business value? How do you go about getting that business value out? A client says, hey, I want this and I want it like yesterday. How do you define the business value for that against the thousands of other user stories that you already have? I mean, we've been doing Agile for, or rather, we have been Agile for more than 10, 15 years now. How do you do that? How do you get to a business value for a story and say, hey, this gives me more business value than that? Yeah. Okay. Okay. Excellent. So that's one way of doing it. For that, I'm going to give you a chocolate. Good catch. Yes. Mm-hmm. So if you have 50 different options, or you know, real world scenario, you have 100 different things, you can't push all 100 out, right? How do you select the four you choose for A/B testing? What do you do? What's the?
Okay.
Fair point. There you go. Okay. So that's the problem. If you notice, right, that seems to be an area which Agile does not, or rather I personally have not seen a lot of real world examples that worked. I mean, I've run sessions for clients. Between Sneha and I, we have run multiple sessions for clients, maybe about 40 or 50. But when it got down to our own world, right, of actually spending money from my pocket and prioritization, I didn't want to do a poker game and prioritize what's important for me. I mean, we're a startup, there are four, five of us. And all of us have the same say. It's not that Sneha owns product and I own development, as my startup friend can attest to that. But everybody's say is important. Now, three of us are debating which should go live, which feature we should pick first. Whoever shouts the loudest should not win. That's not the way it should be. Oh, so that's the problem we were looking at, right? When we started out with Geek Trust, we found out that this was a problem, right? We didn't know how we would prioritize what. It's always like Anand was saying, I think he got his chocolate and ran away. as Anand was saying, it's gut feel, and gut feel just wasn't good enough.
So let's park the problem of prioritization for a bit. And at GeekTrust, like as we said, we are a startup. So what's the we are a bootstrap startup. So the most important thing for us to run our business is our revenues coming in. And if you look at how we get our revenues in, how many of you have heard of a sales funnel?
And how many sales folks in the room? Anybody in sales? Okay.
Okay. So sales funnel for us at GeekTrust is nothing but a funnel through which our customers go through, the different steps through which our customers go through, and the end of it, we make money. That's sales funnel for us. And for example, so GeekTrust is an online recruitment platform. So at a very high level, any user who comes onto our platform registers, goes through a few things, and finally, if they get placed at a job, that's how we make money. So for us, the sales funnel is the different steps that a user goes through, which ultimately leads to revenues for us.
Is that clear? And I think that's simple enough. Like if you pick even an e-commerce player like Flipkart, that's how they make money.
Yeah.
Right? You have somebody landing on the page. Now you take them through the entire process where they buy something and they get money. They get a commission. Probably not, but let's imagine they do. Right? So that's the situation. Is that clear? So sales funnel is clear and the problem statement of prioritization is clear. Now, we were drawing out the sales funnel for GeekTrust. Right? We were looking at what are the different stages. And then it just struck us. One day we had a realization. What if we married the sales funnel with our product prioritization, right? Because for us, what is the most important thing? We are bootstrapped by choice, by the way. What is the most important thing to make revenue? To move a customer through the sales funnel. That is how we make money. So we came up with this model. This is a very, very poorly drawn funnel. I admit it, I drew it myself. Sneha has better handwriting than me. But this is how we came up with this idea of funnel-based product development. You prioritize your features depending on which part of the sales funnel it hits and how you want to move your customer forward. Sort of vague, I mean, the idea makes sort of sense. We'll go through the detail, I'll pick an example and we'll go through that. But any questions so far? Is this idea sort of, does it intuitively make sense? Yeah, especially a B2C player, I mean, B2C company, which is, you know, the product is the website. Yep.
So even for you to figure out the first journey down, which is your MVP, you could even define the whole funnel itself. Like initially, you may not have the full funnel built up. If you think of the funnel as exact steps, you might have, instead of say 6 steps, you might have 4 steps. So it still applies to your MVP itself. And even for your MVP, you'll still tie it down to what is it that gets you revenue, or what is it that gets your customer converted on your site.
So imagine you are starting up tomorrow. Which part of the funnel will you hit? Right. So I'm not sure about that. I'm not sure I agree with that. And because as a startup, and what we want to do is, I'm not worried, and this is what we really did, okay? I'm not worried about this part of the funnel. For me as a startup, in my first 2 months, I'm just worried about this. Exactly, exactly. I want people to hit my bloody website first,
yeah.
Right, and get their email addresses. Yeah. So the first thing we did was just a page which said, hey, we are coming soon, are you interested, right? So now what we'll do is, we'll use a real world example, not a real world example, but an example. Imagine this website called smellniceonceinawhile.com. Okay, it's a new website that we're coming up. It helps you buy perfumes online. Okay, so that's our example. That's a website all of us are going to start up with tomorrow, right? It's a pretty big team. There are only a few developers. The rest of operational head we lay off tomorrow. But imagine we are starting up. I'm joking. I'm overhead myself.
So for our website, smellniceonceinawhile.com, we need users to come and buy perfumes on our site. So that is the business model. That's how we make money. So before defining the funnel for this website, let's figure out what are the profiles, what are our users, what are the potential user base, and that's where user persona comes into picture. Have you guys heard of user personas before?
Anybody okay. Who's not? It's okay to say you're not. Yeah.
Okay. Cool. Fine. So user persona is nothing but imagine you profile your user base. and you pick the one, the pick the few user personas that are most likely to come to your site. And a user persona is nothing but defining the whole life of that person in terms of what does a person do, what does the person
like, dislike.
Yeah, and also where is the person in terms of how well he or she understands your business. So for example, you could have people who don't understand e-commerce at all, who are very new to e-commerce, and that will be one set of user personas, whereas on the other extreme, you'll have somebody who's shopping on an e-commerce site day in and day out. So just profiling your users, and then what you end up doing is pick up that one most one persona that covers most of your user base. And in our case, let's think of a persona, say Armani Anand. So Armani Anand is a persona who's very aware of the perfumes that he uses, who knows what perfume brands exist, and who buys perfume online. So he's on the extreme where he understands e-commerce, he understands his perfumes really well, and he knows what he is buying on your site.
So for those who know user personas, does this make sense? And imagine Armani being a high-end perfume you want to buy, and this guy is called Anand, so it sort of naturally clicks. This is my main user. And now we apply the user persona to the funnel, to the sales funnel that we had earlier, which is, again, in my poorly written handwriting, Armani Anand at the beginning of the funnel. We have done something to get him to the beginning of the funnel. Then he searches for what perfume he wants. He sees the reviews, he adds to cart, etc. I mean, you know how it is. This is just a sample. But he goes, or she, in this case, he goes through the funnel, right? This makes sense? Any questions? Armani Anand lands and he goes through the funnel. And when he finally makes a purchase is when we earn revenue, right? Now what do you guys think, and girls think, what's the next thing we should do? Now we have Armani Anand going through the funnel. How does this help with prioritization at all? So the next thing we did is,
So the next thing we did is we put conversion numbers. So basically tracking Armani Anand through the site, or the Armani Anand's similar personas through the site, what is the conversion rate? How many people who search on the site actually end up seeing reviews? How many people who see reviews end up adding the product to cart? And so on, all the way up to the end of the funnel. So these are actual conversion numbers that every business should be tracking, because if you don't know what your customer is doing on your site, then you have a big problem.
Yep. Yes. Sure. Agreed. Yes. So it need not, see, in your particular case, the funnel may be a little different.
Exactly.
Right. The funnel may not have a search in it. Right. It'll just have four products in it and say move forward.
And,
it could
and
be
if
different.
You think of a very, very MVP thing, the funnel might just be a search and buy. That's pretty much it.
Could be, yes.
Exactly. So the funnel is just an... Exactly. Exactly. So this is just an example, but your steps in the funnel could vary based on where you are with your product, how early, how late in the market you are, and a lot of other things.
And I'd like to also talk about how important the conversion numbers are. So we are very small. Our numbers are not high, right? The number of people hitting is not high, but it gives us patterns. It shows us that out of X people hitting our site, 3% convert. Out of 3% who convert, 4% update their profile. Out of that, the next percentage is this. And it's not too difficult to do. Nowadays, with Google Analytics, with Mixpanel, with all of these things, you can easily find this out, right? And this is extremely important. You need to know what are the stages and what are the conversions to the different stages. Was there a question then? Yeah. This is just a sample channel, but great question. Bad catch. But yes, you know, as it gets more complex, you could have multiple funnels, right? And in some funnels won't be a straight funnel. There might be a feedback loop in the funnel. There could be different things that could happen. But this is just one channel. I'm just picking a straw man.
And right? And based on different journeys also, you could have different funnels. They may not be just one way to end up buying a product on your site. There could be different ways. So there'll be different funnels for different things that you could do on the site.
Yeah, and this is, yeah. I'll talk. How do you prioritize across the journey? Right, you have a customer journey which is there. What we are trying to show you is how do you decide which part of the journey you're going to pick to build first? Yes.
Yeah. Conversion numbers is the most important thing in this funnel-based product development.
Yep. Move to the next stage.
This is just move. Yeah.
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 Yep.
So this funnel could have different branches also based on what you could do, and they could directly end up there as well.
Right. See, I tried to keep the numbers sort of realistic. 40% of people see reviews, and probably only 2% add to cart. But once you get them to the payment page, bloody well, 80%, 90% should move to the next stage, right? That's what you'd expect. Yep. Yeah, good catch. I was hoping you wouldn't ask this question. This may not work in that context. So if your product is not your business, right? If your product does not lead to direct sales for you, this may not work.
But it still applies because you're still building something. Oops. Even if it's B2B.
I got one for you as well.
Exactly. Yeah.
Yeah. So. But the enterprise product, if one of your sales channel is through the web, is through online sales, right? Yeah. You could have a landing page and you could use that, right? You could see just customer acquisition could be a funnel, right? People who register and say, I'm interested. That's it. Right.
Exactly.
Yeah, see, it could be, but even if it's not cloud, right, you still need every single company in the world has a website, and it says, hey, contact me for more details. That is also a funnel. Somebody lands there, you pique their curiosity, you give them information, and they say, I'm interested in this product, tell me more details. It's not the same as this. This is much, much more effective in a B2C sort of environment, but in B2B also it works. But and cloud, yeah, you're right, absolutely it works.
Even in the B2B case, right, so here it's easy for us to pick that, you know, the most important thing for this business is revenues. In a B2B case, it may not be that. The most important thing for you is, are people using my product? Exactly, I was just coming to that. So I'm saying you don't necessarily need to tie it to revenue. It's a B2B where, you know, it's not direct revenues. It could be how engaged are people, how people are using your product.
See, you could do this for Twitter as well, right?
Yeah.
In Twitter, the goal of a Twitter product manager is more engagement. So the output will not be revenue, it will be engagement, but there are different parts of the funnel. See, that, actually, let me park that. I think in that B2B context, what you said just now doesn't work because it's not in that context that we are saying here. This is purely from a B2C model. B2B, it'll work, but for the example you quoted, this won't work. So I'm just going to move a little bit because we have like 2 minutes left. I'm speaking?
Yeah.
And then, you know, you want to put your target numbers, right? You put your target numbers saying that, you know, initially you had 20%, now you want 30%, now you want 40%. Then you want to move it to 50 from 2 to 5. Okay, let's pause here. This is where it is really useful. Now, every time Sneha tells me, let's build this feature, you know what question I ask? I ask her, which part of the funnel does it hit? And how much will it increase my conversion rate? The conversations are all objective. There is no gut feel. And you are forced to take a stance. Right? If Sneha comes and says, you know what, let's build this cool feature over here, and I'll go like, but our conversion that is already okay. You don't have to worry about it. Let's fix this part of the funnel. Which feature? So every single feature at GeekTrust today, we start by saying, which part of the funnel will we hit with this feature? And how much do we expect to increase the conversion by? We didn't do any poker planning. This is very simple to do. And you know, as a startup, you decide and prioritize features every 2 days, every 3 days. And we always go back to this. Which part of the funnel does it hit? How much will it improve our conversion by? Was there a question at the back? No. Yes. See, if you're tracking your customers, right?
Yeah.
You'll know if your funnel is right or wrong. You'll notice that customers go through a certain path. And if your conversion numbers are not adding up, you'll know that something is wrong.
There are a lot of analytics tools which help you out with what your customers are doing on your site as well. And that itself is a validation of where your funnel is headed towards.
You start with the hypothesis, then you test it on the real world. It would not? It could be, yeah.
Yes.
You need to figure that out. Yes, question at the back. That is true. We know our current numbers. That is factual, right? It is 65%, right? Target numbers, in true agile mode, we try and make it incremental. We don't go for big leaps. From 60%, let's make it 65% or 63%, right? We can't afford to make big leaps as well. So that's how we do it. So that's pretty much it. We just want to introduce this idea that we had. It worked really well for us. Not sure if I was at ThoughtWorks whether I'd be able to implement this, but for a startup, this works out beautifully. Right, we don't have to fight as much anymore. We'll just say which part of the funnel do we hit with this feature, and why is it more important than that other feature? Yep. Huh. Yeah. I think that, of course, that plays into it, right?
Yeah.
If there is something which is very small and easy to do, actually, I'm not so sure. You know, we have two developers in our team, right? Even if it's very small and easy to do, even if it takes only 4 hours to do, I would rather not do that. Right, do
so
the thing which hits our funnel the most and increase our conversion numbers.
Yeah.
If we had the time
yes.
to, we would definitely do that. Yeah. We should.
Yes.
Quite honestly, we have not started that yet, but it's on our to-do list of doing AB, at least two rounds of the same. Right. So we see whether there's an uptake depending on the feature, quite honestly.
Yeah.
Right? If it's something on the beginning of the funnel, right, it's easy to test.
Yeah.
We'll know within a week whether it's worked or not. We built a feature, our target was 10,000 hits, we hit 2,500. It didn't work. It didn't work as much as we wanted to. So it depends on feature to feature, but within a week you'll get a sense of whether it's starting to move up or not.
Yes.
Yes. Yes.
Course
absolutely.
Correction is like every minute, especially at a startup.
Yeah. Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah.
Cool. That's our talk. That's all it is. Thanks a lot.
Yeah.